Like my hair is just as bad. Good morning, guys. It is Thursday, December the 8th, and today I have a visitor from Florida. So you guys will remember Stephanie from earlier videos. But basically, yeah, we connected really well when I was in Florida, and now she is here visiting me in Kelowna. So we're just out on my deck. We're gonna go get some more for her first time. Oh, and we have a push day planned today, so Stephanie's gonna be benching, and I'm gonna be benching as well. I think I'm gonna do some like heavy doubles and or triples today. So I came back from my protein. Also, it was warm. It was like decently warm. It got absolutely freezing just in time when Stephanie got here. She got in last night, by the way, and she's here for 2 weeks, right?
Yes, 2 weeks.
Hi. I'll get a medium coffee with skim milk and one Splenda, please. I'm gonna get a Santa's favorite vanilla dip, old fashioned plain donut, please. So you guys just got coffee. Now we're gonna head to a place called Mad Mango Cafe. Kind of like traditional breakfast, but then they also have, I don't even know, they have like Asian dishes and stuff.
Interesting. Yeah, so. But breakfast food?
Yeah, I think so. I'm actually curious to see what you're gonna get here.
I used to make hot and sour soup almost every day.
That's what I'm gonna get. That's what kind of what I was in the mood for, like eggs and ham and toast and hash browns. So here is meal one. So I've got 3 whole eggs. I'm eating heavily because I'm gonna be bench pressing heavily later. Some hash browns, a slice of ham, whole wheat toast with mango jam, which is super good. And the tiniest glass of orange juice of all time. What'd you get?
I got a breakfast wrap with, there's eggs, tomatoes, lettuce, and ham, and something red at the bottom. Oh, salsa.
Looks good.
Like a breakfast wrap.
Okay, so guys, just a quick update. We finished breakfast at the Mad Mango Cafe. I just had like a crazy long nap, because, I don't know, didn't sleep too much last night. So slept for like a couple hours, and now it is 2:35. And I'm gonna grab a quick pre-workout meal and a Monster, and then we're gonna hit the gym. So good. So guys, this is the pre-workout meal. I've got chicken, jasmine rice, salsa, sour cream, cheddar cheese all mashed up. And then this is what I had left of the donuts. And then Stephanie has exactly the same thing. I got a bunch of new stuff coming from Rise. Kind of been like opening it as I use it. So I'm just gonna try to pick out a new shirt that I should wear for this workout. So I actually kind of like this tank top, the like blue.
It's nice. That's super nice.
Yeah, I like this one.
Yeah, it's nice. I like it. Mm. Either one would probably be nice, so.
There's so much stuff. This one here.
Oh, that's really nice. They look more like lifestyle t-shirts.
So I had my last meal probably a little bit over an hour ago. And so when that's the case, I do find sometimes I'll start to feel a little bit low blood sugar or just a little bit hungry in the gym. So I find having some kind of carb source during training can help. Over, I want to focus on bench pressing since we spent a good deal of this workout benching and then we moved on to some pec and shoulder isolation stuff. So first I want to cover my particular style of bench press technique. First is the setup. So there are 2 basic methods that you can use here. One is called the feet up method, and this is the one where you put your feet up on the bench and then you set up your arch from there. While it works fine, it isn't my preference simply because I find I can lose my positioning when I bring my feet from the bench down to the floor. I prefer prefer the pull-through method, which is where you set up with your upper torso sort of off the bench or behind the bench, with your hands at the proper grip width on the bar. You go up onto your toes and sort of simultaneously hyperextend your lower back while driving your hips up in the air. Then from here, I think about driving my upper traps straight down into the bench. And I actually think about getting my upper spine as vertically as I humanly possibly can. At the same time, I'm pinching my shoulder blades together as if trying to squeeze a pencil between them. Next, I sort of subtly rotate my elbows forward, and this slight movement basically just cues me to depress my shoulder blades. Then I grip the bar as hard as I possibly can and cue for an unrack from a spotter. And here you want to think about lifting the bar out, not up, and you should tell your spotter this. You should completely maintain the tightness that you established in the setup as you get the lift off. If you do lose that tightness, then just simply re-rack the weight and do your full setup and lift off again. Right before you descend, you want to take a huge breath and simultaneously puff your chest out. Then start bringing the bar down with your breath held. And here I actually do something that's a lot less common. I allow the bar to come down quite quickly. I maintain tightness, but I do have a much speedier eccentric than most competitive powerlifters. And I think that whether or not you do this will come down to individual preference mostly. However, if your eccentric is too slow, then you'll just simply start to fatigue the muscles contracting eccentrically to resist the force of gravity. And on the other hand, if your eccentric is too fast, it's going to be more difficult to overcome that downward momentum of the bar when it reaches your chest. In my case, because I actually sink the bar into my rib cage and allow it to recoil rather than allowing it to come to a soft stop on my chest, I find that the faster eccentric allows for a more reactive or reciprocal force generation off of my chest.
Force generation off of my chest.
Dozing off them zinies, just popped the bandit. Wave rock like a line, it froze like a line. Body at the fix, damn, that's so outlandish.
Straight up,
she gon' make it clap.
So guys, it just hit 335 for a double. It went up fairly smooth, but like the liftoff was kind of shitty. Terrible liftoff. Just kidding. But yeah, it came off like a little bit weird, so it was like kind of out in front of me.
This don't kill my vibe. This don't kill my vibe. I can feel your energy from two planets away. I got my drink, I got my music, I will share it, but today I'm getting.
Look inside of my soul and you can find gold and maybe get rich.
Admittedly, this method won't be for everyone or even most, as a lot of people tend to lose tightness when they allow the bar to sink. So I would recommend starting with a soft pause, like Stephanie is doing here, where you allow the bar to softly make contact and then you actively reverse the direction of motion by driving your heels into the floor, or more helpfully, you want to think about pushing the floor away from you as you drive the bar simultaneously up and back. So a couple other quick things that I wanted to mention, the first being grip width. I personally find that a wider grip, so I put my ring finger on the neural mark, and that allows me to just obtain a stronger press. I think that this is something you kind of just have to play around with, but in my experience with myself and with my athletes, I find that generally wider is better to a point. So you should at least try it out and see for yourself. Secondly, I often get asked why I arch like this, and there are four main reasons that I came up with. There might be more. The first one being it creates a higher contact point, or in other words, it reduces the range of motion. And of course, all else being equal, a shorter range of motion will allow for more weight to be moved. Secondly, it reduces the external moment arm at the shoulder joint. And what I mean by this is, since rotation is happening at the shoulder joint and the bar is contacting the chest well in front of the shoulder, there is what's called a moment arm created. Or in essence, it makes the weight effectively heavier because of the torque generated around the shoulder. However, when you arch, you shorten this moment by sort of crunching your upper spine together and reducing the distance between your shoulder and the bar. Thirdly, it increases tightness. So this basically means that your muscles have to do less stabilizing because everything is perfectly locked into position, which means the muscles can more actively contribute to actually doing the pressing. And number four, it creates a safer shoulder position, especially when combined with scapular retraction and a slight elbow tuck. Rather than discuss this in any detail, I'll just link a good article on it in the description. Finally, I want to talk about the efficacy of a powerlifting style bench press for pec development. And I will talk about this in a little bit more detail in my Chest Science Explained video, but for now I'll just voice two of the most common common arguments that I hear against using a powerlifting style bench press for hypertrophic purposes. And those are a shortened range of motion generated by the arch, and that the movement is functionally a decline press, which implies that the application of force is more in line with the lower fibers of the pec and not so much the bulk of the transverse fibers of the mid pec or the descending fibers of the upper pec. And so I'll just address the first criticism first. While range of motion is commonly touted as being extremely important for hypertrophy, I'm only aware of 3 studies that have actually looked into this, and only 2 of them found that training with an increased range of motion resulted in greater hypertrophy. Furthermore, a 2013 review by Fisher and colleagues stated that evidence suggests that a partial range of motion can still produce significant hypertrophic gains with no discernible difference to the gains made from repetitions performed through a full range of motion. Of course, it still makes more sense to me biomechanically to train through a greater range of motion, given that you have greater stretch on the muscle fibers and likely a greater contractile stimulus through which to signal for growth. However, there is nonetheless most likely a trade-off between being able to move more weight through a shorter range of motion and move less weight through a greater range of motion. And I think that somewhere in the middle, there's probably a money spot, but since we have the ability to combine different exercises when programming for hypertrophy, I think it makes most sense to use the powerlifting style bench press to build core strength that can then be applied to other movements, such as a flat dumbbell press or an incline dumbbell press, which have a greater range of motion. And as for the second argument about it being a decline press, while the premise is true insofar as the positioning of the upper torso is functionally equivalent to that of a decline press, it's a bit of a non sequitur since EMG data has shown that the decline press yields greater overall pec activation than both the flat and the incline. So from an overall activation perspective, the decline press is perhaps the best movement to include in your routine. So with all that said, I would agree that if you had to pick only one movement, maybe the powerlifting style bench press wouldn't be the most optimal one from a purely hypertrophic standpoint. But as soon as you start introducing other movements, these issues to do with the fiber orientation become less significant to irrelevant. And plus, using a combination of angles and planes of motion is generally accepted as being the best for overall growth anyway. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, I do still like being strong. I like being able to power lift as much as my back will currently allow for. So it is a fun way for me to train with heavy weights. And in my experience, progressing in a clear, objective, and numerical way can really be a strong motivator in the gym. Okay, so that's going to conclude my bench press commentary, guys. Don't forget to check out the description box for helpful links. Like the video now so you don't forget. That helps me a ton as a growing YouTuber. So I always appreciate that very much, and I hope that you guys enjoy the rest of the vlog. Yeah, it was a good workout. At 350 by 2, I don't think I've ever done anything for a double that high, so that's technically a PR. Really, really psyched about that. I'm thinking on a good day, like if I ate a little bit more, like I only had 2 meals today, and it's 7 p.m. now, so if on a day that maybe I ate a little bit more, maybe had a little bit more rest, I might be able to bust out 375. And Stephanie and I are gonna go get some sushi. So show you guys what I did over there. I always start with edamame because it's a good source of protein as the starter, edamame. Okay, so guys, here's what I got. So this is called a popcorn roll. I think it's, is that shrimp? It's like a little baby shrimp tempura, I think. And there's tempura bits in with like some mayo. Got salmon nigiri and California rolls. And Stephanie has...
Red snapper.
Okay. Yeah, it looks super good. Bring me this. Check it out. I fell in love, fell out of love. We both had options. I played the drums, you rolled the drugs. I rocked the club. We both throw up. We was the band you never heard before. Hello.
The rest of our movie.